email. It says, talk on empathy, including many aspects, including psychology, neurobiology, genetics, evolutionary psychology and pathology, as well as its huge importance in human relationships. Then we're going to have a discussion. So we're looking forward to this. Thank you, Simon. I'll hand over. It's all in your hands.
Okay, so empathy is, I hope to convince you, a very fascinating subject. I think to start with, we need to decide what we mean by empathy. And I guess there are two main parts to empathy. Oh, this is the subject I'm going to talk about. What is empathy? Why does empathy vary? Some people are more empathic than others. Why? What causes low empathy? Because it's low empathy that's often the problem. People with high empathy cause little problem to anyone apart from themselves. And how can we increase empathy, which is a perennial question. So, here is somebody who is struggling and they're frustrated. So there are two steps. Firstly, you've got to recognise and feel for her plight and understand her plight. And then at least you've got to want to get up and help her, and hopefully you will. So there are two sort of aspects. The recognition of how somebody feels and a desire to do something about it. Now, I'm going to talk now quite a lot about the psychology of empathy before we come on to the neurobiology. Psychologists talk about emotional empathy to start with, and I'm going to come to another main category. Emotional empathy is something that's phylogenetically very old. That's to say, it dates back a long time through evolution. And there's a phrase, phylogeny recapitulates ontology, which basically means that things that happen in early stages of evolution are often mirrored by the way we progress from fetus, embryo to fetus, to baby to adult. So what you see in some of the animals is similar to what you see in some of the children. So the first and most basic empathy is what's called emotional contagion. And you see this in animals, you see this in even quite young children, even babies. If their mother cries, they start crying. It's as though they've been affected by the same symptom. They catch their tears. And again, you see this in animals as well. The next is personal distress. And this is when you're distressed by what somebody else feels. Now, you don't feel the same as them. You've got to distinguish sympathy from empathy. If you've both got an arrow sticking in your backside, you will feel the same. That is sympathy. Empathy is not feeling the same. So, for example, if somebody is very depressed, even suicidal, you feel very distressed about it and for them, but you don't feel depressed or suicidal yourself. Somebody falls and hurts themselves. You're distressed for them, but you don't actually feel the pain. So that's a big difference between empathy and sympathy. And there is empathic concern. And this is really a slightly higher order thing in which people actually feel driven to do something, called pro-social behaviours, in which case you might help somebody, even in a sort of way that is to your own detriment. You might help somebody who you have to go out of your way to help somebody, or help somebody who's stigmatised and so on. So those are the sort of basic emotional empathies. Now, some of you may have heard philosophers say that all empathy is in fact selfish, and that it's not sort of altruistic, it's not for other people, it's for yourself. And the reason they say this is that you help somebody else because you're distressed, and it's actually truly your distress, so you're doing it for yourself. Also, there are genes that confer an empathic tendency, and if you help people with those genes, you're perpetuating that gene line. So this is what's referred to as a selfish gene. And in this sense, all genes are by definition selfish. And then, of course, there's a sort of kudos of helping somebody else and being sort of getting public a reward for that. And lastly, you help other people for personal gain because sort of I scratch your back, you scratch mine. Now, there's no doubt at all that in animals in whom their behaviour is almost entirely innate, genetic, and have very little culture, these actually apply, all right? And there is probably no truly altruistic behaviour. But we're very different because we have an immense and complex culture, we have memes that sometimes are more important than genes, and we undoubtedly have truly altruistic behaviour, as well as some self-serving behaviours as well. Yes, now don't you take it. So now we come on to something slightly different. Emotional empathy is I sense what you feel and I may act on it at various levels, from its basic level, ending up with empathic concern. Cognitive empathy is something that is pretty unique to human beings, some of the higher primates possibly to a small extent. And it involves what's called the theory of mind. If you don't know what the theory of mind is, it may seem strange, but animals do not appear to realise that other animals have minds independent of their own. You can tell this from putting them in experimental situations, watching their behaviour. And young children don't either. So, for example, if you take a very young toddler and he sees his father put some chocolate in the cupboard, father goes to work, the toddler sees his mother take the chocolate from the cupboard and put it in the fridge. Then the father comes home and you say to the child, where's daddy going to look for the chocolate? And the child says, well, you look in the fridge. That's where the chocolate is. But an older child would say, he'll look in the cupboard, but of course it's not there. Because he realises his father has a mind different from his and knows things, they know things that the other one doesn't know. So, examples of cognitive empathy, a simple example would be imagining what this room was like if I was standing outside and looking in. So sort of visualising something. To much more complex things, like I might be wondering whether John realises that I know that Len hasn't done something that he should have done, and so sort of third-order complex understandings. So emotional empathy is a more intense thing, and it's I sense what you feel. And cognitive empathy involves the other mind's problem, and it's more I understand how you feel. All right. Now, it may seem a slightly arbitrary distinction, but you'll see later on they do separate out in both psychological and neuroscience investigations. How do you measure empathy? Well, there are various ways. This is a part of a much longer questionnaire, which measures the empathy quotient, rather like the IQ is for intelligence. And there are other ones, there's the interpersonal reactivity index and various others, and they're fairly well validated and robust. And a test like this will give you an overall EQ, empathy quotient, and it'll tend to separate out the emotional, I sense what you feel, and the cognitive, I understand what you feel, empathy, and will also include a sort of factor as to whether or not you actually act on your empathy, which is quite a cultural thing. In England, we don't like to interfere. Other countries leap in and help people straight away. Not exclusively. Okay, so if you measure empathy in a population, this is what you get. This is what's called a normal distribution. People with high empathy on this side, people with low empathy on that side. It's the same distribution you get for measuring height or intelligence or anything. Most people in the middle, some people high empathy, and some people low empathy. Now I'm going to be talking about the high and low ones in a moment, because they're a particularly interesting group. But most of us are in this area here. So why is there a variation in empathy? Why are some people more empathic than others? And there can only be two reasons. One is they're born that way, due to their genes. It's innate, it's inherited. That's nature. Or it's nurture. It's what happened to them, their upbringing, their education, their experience of life. Or, of course, a combination of the two. And what's interesting is trying to work out the proportions of the variation. Now, there's a wonderful experiment I should just mention, women are rather more empathic in general than men. That doesn't come any surprise to you ladies, does it? Of course, it's a huge overlap, but the average is a slightly different. So, if you take twins, and a lot of twins around, one in 80 births are twins, and you compare identical twins who have the same genes with non-identical twins, which have similar genes, as similar as any two brothers or two sisters might have, and you look at the concordance, how similar they are to one another. And if identical twins are a lot more similar in what you're looking at than non-identical twins, that is a measure of the genetic effect. So for example, in empathy, about 55% of the variation in the population, okay, is genetically determined. Now, if you compare that to IQ, intelligence, it's about 80%, and the tendency to be happy is about 40% genetic. In fact, happiness is another interest of mine. If you want to talk another day, I'll give you a talk on happiness. Happiness is very interesting because, as I say, whether you're a happy bunny or miserable git, it's partly dependent on your genes and also dependent on your childhood, the sort of upbringing you've had. And so, but there's still probably about 40% of the variation that's affected by your life. So you can actually make yourself more happy and other people more happy. Okay, so in other words, it's more about just over half of the variation in empathy is due to inheritance. And that's particularly for the emotional inheritance, which is a sort of more older system in terms of evolution and occurs more in younger children, younger people, and less so for cognitive empathy, which is something relatively newer in evolution and tends to be more obvious in adults as they acquire more knowledge about the world. Now, those questionnaires are obviously useful in adults, but you can actually assess empathy in toddlers, and there's a variety of experiments that can be done. This is just one of many. The mother will pretend that she's caught her finger in the door, and ow, like this, and you see what the child, how they react. And you can measure the scoring systems, and in fact it's very interesting that toddlers, their emotional quotient is, the empathy quotient is actually very similar to parents. Their parents' emotional quotient of the most basic sort of. Okay, so what I've been talking up till now about is psychology, how the mind handles empathy. I'm a neurologist, and what I'm interested in is the brain. And I'm interested in particular in John's brain. How does John, very empathic guy, how does his brain handle empathy? Now, in order to do this, I'm going to have to remove his brain. John, I will be gentle and I will trample him back around. Okay. So, let us think a little bit about the brain. Now, our first inkling about empathy in the brain is this series of experiments, which goes back about 20 years now. At the front of the brain here, what's called the inferior frontal gyrus, if you put very fine electrodes, electrodes into that area there, you can find cells, neurons, that respond if the monkey reaches for an object with either hand, or with its foot, or with its mouth, or if another monkey reaches for that object, or if even a human reaches for that object. So it's called a mirror neuron because not only is it related to a function that the monkey does, but to what another monkey or another person does as well. It sort of mirrors the action. And people weren't sure this was due to, some people thought it might be due to learning, due to imitation of others. Other people thought it might be due to empathy. But really, it didn't tell us a great deal about humans. Now, let's think a little bit about humans. Has anybody heard of this guy, Phineas Gage? Very famous among psychologists. Now, Phineas worked on the railways and in 1848 he was blowing up rocks, as was his job, in Vermont in America. And he'd have a great rock, and he'd drill a hole, he'd put gunpowder in, he'd push the gunpowder down with this metal rod, and bang, it went off. And the metal rod was driven up under his ear, behind his eye, and came out the top of his head. And when I say came out, it went straight through. He didn't even lose consciousness. And he sat up all the way to hospital in the horse and cart. And he lived another 12 years. But he changed. Before, he was polite and pleasant, but after, he was childish and rude and had no inhibitions and he had no empathy. And when they later, when he died, and they looked at his skull and lined up the fractures as he went in and left, they worked out that the area of the brain that was damaged was the inferior frontal gyrus. So that suggests again that this area is important in some aspects of empathy. Okay, so what I've been talking about is damage to the brain, cases like Phineas Cage. And this was the main way that neurologists and neuroscientists worked out what different parts of the brain did, how the brain functioned. We had to study somebody in which one part was damaged. But in recent years, we have what's called cognitive neuroscience. And this is methods of studying the intact brain, like John Stafford's brain. Okay, so many of you will have seen one, some of you will have been inside one of these. This is an MRI scan. It's fantastic. So this is the sort of picture it produces. This is a slice through the brain here. And it shows you, it just shows you the structure, nothing else. But by using radioisotopes that are selectively picked up where there's increased metabolism or increased oxygen usage, you can see which parts of the brain are active during certain mental activity. So it shows a functional MRI scan, fMRI, shows both structure and function. So, I'm going to describe some classic experiments. This is an incredibly oversimplified account of what goes on in the brain during activities such as empathy. This is sort of more like a taster, more like an introduction. Okay, so here are some happy, disgust, anger, sad, very easily recognized emotions. And you show people these cards and while they're in the MRI scan and you see which parts of their brain light up. And lo and behold, it's our inferior frontal gyrus again. Okay, and it lights up whichever emotion, whether it's a nice emotion or a nasty one. The amount it lights up correlates well with their emotional, their empathy quotient as measured by questionnaires. It's also affected by context. So, for example, this area lights up more if it's somebody, if it's somebody you know and like who's in pain, and if it's very unfair pain. Whereas if it's somebody you don't like and you feel it's perhaps what they deserve, it lights up rather less. So this is affected by obviously more complex things, and that's of course what we experience in real life. So that area there is the same area as Phineas Gage's rod went through, and the same area that the mirror neurons reside in. This is a huge area of research here. So after stroke affecting different parts of the brain, you can look to see which aspects of empathy are affected. This is a very, very oversimplified account. We've already talked about emotional empathy particularly is affected by this area. It's affected in this area, the area of the mirror neurons. But like I said, there's also, as well as emotional empathy, we've got cognitive empathy, and there's an area just below the frontal lobe, just above where the eyes are, called the ventromedial prefrontal area, that's damaged impairment of cognitive empathy. And what's interesting is you can get damage to one without damage to the other. It's not as though emotional empathy is a sort of basic form of cognitive empathy. They seem to be two separate systems. What John Haight would call the rider and the elephant.
the elephant being the basic, more primitive, atavistic emotions. Let's say they're independent systems. Now, you know, I'm really worried that there's some neuroscientists here saying, this is just balderdash. You're just oversimplifying things. Yes, I am. I haven't got one, and I'm keeping it simple, because I just really want to explain some sort of basic ideas. In fact, there are not just those two areas. There are about 10 areas involved in empathy, but those are perhaps the two most important and the most illustrative. Now, what are the causes, then, of loss of empathy? We've talked about genetics. Some people, their parents, one or both, have low empathy, and they may as well. We've talked about brain damage, particularly those frontal areas. And some brain diseases can also have a similar effect. And childhood emotional trauma can as well. And this is very important, because unlike the others, this is something we really can prevent. I mean, brain damage and brain disease are quite rare, but childhood emotional trauma, we're talking here about neglect, physical, emotional and sexual abuse, not having the equivalent of a parent, the sort of awful experiences the Romanian orphans went through. Many of them have grown up with impaired empathy. And they came from a wide range of families. It wasn't an inherited thing in them. John Bowlby, who's the child psychologist most interested in attachment theory, he referred to the internal pot of gold that comes from having a loving, unconditional love as a baby and child, which you carry around with you all your life, and gives you the courage to experiment, to have relationships, to have intimacy, and without that, you can have impaired empathic function. And these are examples of childhood emotional abuse. And of course, some children have parents who have emotional problems, so they perhaps have a low genetic endowment, and they have parents who perhaps don't look after them as well as they should, so they're put a double whammy. That is why it is so important that we have organisations like Sure Start to help those families who are at risk. And those families are really pleased. You know, some families don't like social workers coming in, but this is one case where people are very grateful. Okay, so what about the people at the end of the spectrum? What about people with high empathy? You might think that's good. Yes, it is good. It's better than low empathy. They all tend to be rather more sensitive, and they tend to take everybody's problems on themselves. And there is therefore a slight problem with people with very high empathy. They have to sometimes learn not to try and sort out everybody's problems. But that's not usually a big issue. It's more commonly women, and these are women who have intuitive empathic abilities. So, for example, cancer, they'll come in and they'll immediately see John and they'll, how are you, John? They really want to know how he is. And they'll look at him and they'll say, John, you're not looking very happy. And John says, yeah, well, Dr. Nightingale's going to put lectures into my brain. You know, so they have very intuitive, they sense through body language and the way you speak your emotional state, and they are very good at responding and listening. And they have a range of emotional repertoire themselves. Now, it's the ones at the end of the spectrum that are particularly interesting. They are a very big problem in psychology, and particularly in psychiatry and in criminology, and for society in general. And we could perhaps talk a little bit about them. I might say that I will be talking about various forms of psychopathy, abnormality of the minds, and it sounds like I'm making caricatures of these people. They are caricatures in the sense that you will recognize the type, but these people are as deserving of our compassion and help as anybody else. Right, so this is based very much on Simon Baron Cohen's work, and he divides people with very low empathy into three sorts. Firstly, the borderline personality. Now, these are much more commonly women, And they have a lifestyle that's self-destructive and impulsive, and they tend to be quite manipulative. They will, for example, appear very weak so that people are drawn to try and look after them, or they'll seduce people. They tend to have huge mood swings. They see everything as black and white. There's nothing in between. There's a thin line between love and hate. They often complain of just feeling empty inside. And 70% of people with borderline attempt suicide, and 10% succeed. So this is the most fatal of all psychiatric diagnoses. And said that Marilyn Monroe was such a person. Now, the narcissistic psychopath is much less common. It's much more common in men than women. And these people, they're self-centered, they believe they're better than other people, that they're gifted, and it's all hubris, no humility. They tend to be very boastful, they have a sense of entitlement. People should look looking after me, doing things for me, and if they don't, they get very angry. And these people are dangerous. Most serial killers are narcissistic psychopaths. Not all. Some are paranoid schizophrenic, like Jack the Ripper, etc. And a classic example, of course, of this is Anders Breivik, the Norwegian right-wing guy who shot up a whole lot of children. Now, some people have said that this man is a narcissistic psychopath, because actually he ticks virtually each one of those boxes. There was an interesting letter in The Guardian, which, oh, I've got a couple of Americans here, I'm sorry. There's an article in The Guardian, or a letter in The Guardian, where a professor of forensic psychiatry wrote in about this question. And he said, people with narcissistic personality disorder, it is a recognized psychological disturbance, and these people are deserving of our help and sympathy. Trump is not a narcissistic psychopath. He's just a very unpleasant person. Which I thought was quite funny. I'm not sure whether it was a joke yet or not. Anyway, I don't think he's... I think he's a wonderful person. I think he's absolutely wonderful. Anybody who's got their finger on the atomic... on the nuclear button, I'm not going to be rude about that. The old show's been taken off about. Okay. Now, the last group, and this is the one you probably recognise. These, again, mainly men. They're superficially charming, they have no guilt, no anxiety, they're undependable, dishonest, they're egocentric, they have very limited range of emotions to either recognize in others or display themselves. They don't learn from experience, they don't plan, they have no morality, they exhibit schadenfreude, which basically means they actually enjoy when other people suffer. They are often very good at hiding this personality. And if you show them a picture of a child who's injured, they'll say, oh, that's terrible. And put them in the MRI scanner, it doesn't add up at all. About 15%, I say 1% of the male population generally, 15% of male prisoners are in this category. And in many of them, they've had brain trauma. The incidence of epilepsy, which is a marker for brain damage, is very high among prisoners. And they don't learn from experience, so they keep going back to prison. And of course, classic examples would be the Cray brothers. But of course, the people with the brain damage, maybe they're not as clever as they might be, they tend to get caught. If you're a psychopathic personality are clever, you end up as a hedge fund manager or a politician. Okay, so if you look at the MRI scan of these people, borderline personality and psychopathy, patients that I've been talking about, they are abnormal in both emotional and cognitive empathy. There haven't been so many studies on narcissistic psychopaths because there are fewer of them. Okay, so that's people whose empathy is at a particular level all the time. Now, when I show you this, you're going to recognize this. You have too much to drink, you're tired, you're stressful, empathy flies out of the window. And in fact, if you do the MRI scan at the same time, you'll show the MRI scan is as though you've lost empathy. And then as you recover and feel remorse for what happened, your MRI scan and behavior returns to normal. So I'm not going to talk much about this. People with severe forms of Asperger's syndrome or autism These are all famous people with autism, I guess. Paul Erdős, Kim Peek, and David Tennant. Only David Tennant's alive. They have big problems with empathy, but it's overshadowed by many other aspects of their developmental disorder. And they are often extremely law-abiding because they have their systematizers and they obey rules very rigidly. So they're quite different from psychopaths. It's an interesting area. So how do we increase empathy? Now, has anybody read a book called Angels of a Better Nature by Steven Pinker? It's an extraordinarily good book. And he talks in that about the psychological forces that encourage us to become more civilized and better people. And empathy is one, but also self-control, moral sense, and reason. And he talks about the circle of empathy. In very primitive cultures, you're empathic to your family, maybe to your village, but not other people outside you're very suspicious of. And then as you became more civilized, it was your town, even your nation, but people from a distant part of the world, a different color, a different religion, you felt little empathy towards. I'm also going to come on and talk about developing an empathic perspective. Let's talk a bit more about the circle of empathy. One of the biggest things that's increased the circle of empathy is media. The printing press, in the 200 years or so before the Enlightenment, people learnt about people from other parts of the world. And this made a huge difference to who you were, the range of people you were empathic about. For example, Uncle Tom's Cabin. Uncle Tom's Cabin, Life Among the Lonely. It's interesting, isn't it? The title. That told people about the life of slaves, and suddenly people realized that they weren't animals, which people generally thought they were. They were human beings and deserved our empathy. And of course, now we have social media, the internet, and TV, and film that makes us empathic to people all over the world. And that is actually a relatively new thing. Len, I'm just going to talk very briefly about this. This is more your area than mine. It's an area of meditation called metta. That's the Sanskrit, not the Greek metta. I've got two T's. And, I mean, very, very briefly, this is a form of meditation in which you concentrate on those you love. And you feel empathic to them, you feel loving towards them, and you practice this technique. And then you develop it for people you're slightly maybe indifferent about, neither for or against them. And eventually, with practice, you can do it for people you dislike. And eventually, you end up being empathic for the whole world. And there are various people who are promoting this. This is an extraordinary woman, Karen Armstrong. She's been a nun. She became basically a historian of religion. She's an atheist. She's an atheist now. She won the TED Prize and started the founder. She's the founder of the Chant of Compassion, along with the Dalai Lama. A few other people. And she's written quite a good book, if you're interested, if you have a book club, called 12 Steps to the Compassionate Life, which is a bit like that meta-meditation. It's ways of trying to become more empathic. Then this man, Simon Baron Cohen, I talked about him earlier in relation to autism and Asperger's syndrome. He's a professor at Cambridge, where he runs the Autism Research Centre, and he's, again, got a similar program. And then Shrewsbury. We have the Darwin International Institute for the Study of Compassion. The founder and director is David Pietroni. And he is setting up an institution a bit like the Rhodes Scholarships, so that people from all over the world can apply and come and do PhDs or postdoctorate work at various research centres around the world. And he's, again, setting this up in different universities. And it's very exciting. He's about to appoint the first professor of compassion studies. Now, I'm going to finish by talking a little bit about teaching medical students to be empathic. Now, you know, medical students are a very, very bright bunch, and they're all got a normal range of empathy. Some more than others. Some are going to be people less interested in talking, maybe anaesthetists or surgeons. Others maybe end up psychiatrists or care of the elderly, which is
a lot of psychology and talking.
Still, they vary a bit in that way. But it's quite easy to lose empathy. We notice that the young medical students are full of love of mankind, but when they're doing their house jobs, they become so overworked that they often have difficulty. They have a bit of burnout even at young age. So what I do is, a student may say to me, you know, Dr. Nadiga, if a patient's dying, you know, I can't stop dying, what do I say? I mean, I just don't want to say. Do I say, don't worry? No, that's really patronising. I'll sort you out. You're not going to sort them out. That's just rubbish. You're making yourself feel better. There's nothing we can do. That is completely awful. There's a huge amount you can do. You cannot stop them dying. There's a huge amount you can do. I'll arrange for people to come and help you. In other words, I'm doing things to you, okay, that disempowers you. You're helpless. Or pull yourself together. And if the doctor ever says pull yourself together, you know the proper response? I would defend you in a court of law. So, this is a rather nice cartoon. This doctor says, of course I'm listening to your concerns. Don't you see me making eye contact, striding an open posture, leaning forwards towards you and nodding empathically? That chap has learnt lots of little cliches which the patient very quickly recognises as insincere and patronising. So,
and I'll ask later.
Okay, so what do you tell them? That's a very good point. So I'm going to come to that now. So, what I say to the students is, you cannot learn cliches. You cannot learn phrases, because they'll be exhausted in the first 20 seconds, maybe 10 minutes, or half an hour with a patient. And unless you're a brilliant actor, and even then, the patient will know what you're thinking. So you've got to think it right. You've got to have a clear and appropriate and healthy vision of your relationship with the patient, and then the words will just come. So I say, okay, supposing, let's take something bad, something like motor neuron disease, which is a horrible disease, affects older people, and from the day of diagnosis to death by progressive paralysis and then able to breathe and swallow is about 2.5-3 years. And that's pretty reliable estimate. So how do you relate to somebody who's got major neuron disease? And this is the way I teach them to do it. The patient is going on a journey, right? Now, they know where they are now, and they know where the journey ends. They're going to die in about 2 years. But they have no idea what's going to happen in the meantime, and they are terrified by the unknown. They don't know the road ahead, or the obstacles, or the challenges. Now, in your mind's eye, you see yourself joining the patient on this journey. Not pulling them along, not pushing them, walking beside them, okay, on their journey. You know the road, you've walked it before. And together, you look ahead, and you look at the map together. And together, you make decisions about the route to change. And side by side, you walk this journey, face the obstacles, tackle the challenges. There is no problem in life that can't be faced together. And together, you and the patient, you bring along the wife and the children, the GP, you know, quite all about motor neuron disease, and anybody else you meet along the route. Between you, you gather these people and bring them along. Now, if you have that vision in your mind, the compassionate perspective, this is the effectiveness. It enhances your empathy for the patient, both emotional and cognitive. You see, when you're standing next to them and looking at the terrain ahead, the difficult terrain, you can really have emotional empathy. You can understand how they see it, so it's cognitive empathy as well. Because you're viewing the same thing together. It empowers the patient, because instead of you need some treatment, which I will arrange, I, you, you're talking about we. Mm-hmm. You would never, you say to your companion, let's look at the options. Let's decide what to do, what we'll arrange together. So it's the inclusive grammar, which comes naturally if you're thinking in the right way. Okay. And there is a slight tendency among people, particularly junior doctors, where if they're really distressed by a patient's plight, they say, right, I'll sort you out. The cavalry's here, they come charging in, they're trying to sort everything out. It's inappropriate and it's usually unwanted, and they're really just treating themselves, they're in distress. So if you're standing beside them, looking way ahead and planning together, it stops you doing that. That's not that uncommon. Also, it is a robust, because it's very easy when you're busy and you're not succeeding, the patient's getting worse despite everything you do, to have burnout, apathy, or stress and fear. And that's, of course, what happened at Stafford Hospital. The loss of empathy towards patients caused the bad things that were happening. And it gives you courage. It gives you courage, the doctor courage. It sounds strange, but when you're walking with the patient, you're not alone. You're doing things together. I've had patients who sort of said to me, things aren't going well for him. Don't worry, doctor, we're doing our best. He's comforting me. I remember a couple of daughters came to see me after their father died of major neuron disease. And they said, I just wanted to thank your team, because the last 3 years during which they watched their father die slowly have been wonderful. That is a successful death. That means that the empathic concern of the team looking after him empowered them. They weren't frightened, they felt supported, they were walking with the team rather than being treated as passive patients. And lastly, I tell doctors, it will be much better life for you, because if you are frightened and distressed by every problem you come against, and I'm sure many of you work in similar situations, particularly those who work in church organisations, it is. If you want to succeed with everything you do, you're going to be very unhappy. Whereas if you walk with people along their journey, do what you can, help them whatever way you can, your own lives will be much better, as well as theirs, so it's a double win. So I think we'll stop there and have questions. How are we doing for time? 10 minutes.
I was going to ask this thing about doctors. Are they trained in empathy, or is it just, I'm talking about GP doctors, or is it just something that's either there or not?
No, I think they're all within the normal range, people who go to medical school. Okay. There are a few people who get in who are borderline Asperger's, but they tend to go to the sort of science or the lab laboratories. So they're all got normal ranges of empathy, but empathic skills can be taught. Mm. I teach them, but it's not a common thing to teach. You'll find a lot of doctors say, this is how you tell somebody bad news. You say this and that and the other. I think it's got to come from here, not the head. It's got to come from here. You've got to love. You've got to love your fellow man. Mm. And that way you'll get it right. So that's a little crusade. It's well known among palliative care doctors. Mm. I give this talk sometimes at palliative care conferences and things. And they were like, yeah, we all will agree about that. You've got to feel it here. Yeah. If you don't, you'll crack up, because, looking after people who are guaranteed to die, if you're trying to cure everybody, is a route to disaster. Put it back there.
Thank you. Why do you think it is that sometimes a whole group or nation seems to collectively lose their sense of empathy? And I'm thinking of things like the Holocaust.
Yeah. Well, of course, you don't have empathy for people who aren't human. Now, if you look at the propaganda about the Jews before the Second World War, it was horrendous. Every day, people were reporting digging up gardens of Jewish families and finding non-Jewish babies buried in the garden they'd been using for their special rituals. The
protocol of the Elders of Zion, a fictitious thing about awful Jewish practices. It was horrendous what they were saying. And after a while, people just started believing it. A bit like in America, what they're saying about Muslims. I mean, if people in this country said what they're saying in America about Muslims, they'd be arrested. But in America, it's a land of free speech. And what they're saying is absolutely horrendous. And our humanist group are very worried for Muslims, because you're getting very bad press, and very, very unfairly. You know, bad Muslims are bad humans, they're bad everybody, but, you know, tarring everybody with the same brush is very bad. So I think when you dehumanize somebody, that's one cause. When people are frightened, you know, the loss of empathy, stress, frightened. Yeah. But we've got to watch for that. We've got to watch for those dangerous situations.
President Obama was very concerned about the lack of empathy in his university students. He said it had gone down tremendously from the 1980s. And is this a society as a general? Is it sort of a fear thing that maybe more people are feeling frightened for their by their politicians, because they can provide a fear aspect that makes people lose their empathy? I just wonder if you have any reason why he should have this concern, and what would cause the university students to lose their empathy?
Yes,
I think it's very interesting.
Of course, it depends a little bit on how you express your empathy. And for some people, in the 60s, everything was peace and love, and we wore our hearts on our sleeves. I think sometimes people now feel it's not cool to express those things. I think. Also, there was a movement, sort of Margaret Thatcher-type movement, of greed is good, you know, and you've got to fight to get to the top, and that doesn't encourage empathy, and we need more empathy in big public institutions, including banking, the financial sector, and even in the army. No, the army's changing, but it's quite interesting.
Do you think this also includes the media, the news that comes regularly each day? There's so many catastrophes and depressing features about the news, but that reinforces the negative feeling for us.
Yeah, I think sometimes you can get bad news overload and it doesn't mean much. I think the media know that. I think the media in England is fairly responsible. The internet isn't, and certainly in America doesn't. Well, I say the media in England, I'm talking about the Mail and Express. I think there is a problem with empathy overload, and it's fascinating. One of the quirks of humanity is that we are much more empathic to individuals than we are to groups of people. So, for example, if you ask people randomly taken off the street, would you give £10 to save a life, maybe in Africa? It will definitely save. And they show a picture of something. And they say, yeah, give you 10 quid. And you say to them, okay, I've got 10 people in Africa, okay? If you give me 10 quid, same amount of money, I can save all their lives. They're less likely to. They find it much easier to be empathic if they identify with one person. You know that photograph I showed? That awful, awful photograph of that little child lying on the beach there. That completely changed everybody's attitudes. But if they'd shown a beach with dozens of people there, it would have made a great difference, because that is too much. That's why some of you may have come to the talk we gave on the psychology of charity at our humanist meeting. People have wonderful excuses for not being to charity, like, well, there's so many people who need my money, it's a waste, it's a drop in the ocean. Maybe a drop in the ocean to you, but it's a huge difference to one or two people. It makes a real difference. That might be something we can talk about, the psychology of charity. There's a huge amount, Peter Singer, of course, the philosopher, and there's now a whole group of economists who are looking at economics of charity, like Doing Good Better by an Oxford Don called McCaskill. Fascinating book. Peter Singer wrote a book called For the Life You Save. It's a very readable book, and I can really recommend it.
Well,
I was interested when you were talking about the media helping us to.
Yeah,
possibly. I look at it the other way. The emotional overload, especially the imagery on television and everywhere else, which cools people down and they either go away from or they just ignore it now. And so they have less empathy.
I don't know.
Because they've broken away from it.
Well, suppose there's too many people dying of starvation in a particular country. Okay, you tell people that too many people dying, they say, oh, that's terrible. But at least they feel something. If you didn't tell them at all, I think it is a problem about how we present the appalling inequality of the world to people in a way that's understandable.
Because I'm looking at what goes on in the world now, people are just annoyed. You know, what's happening in Syria, what's happening in Palestine, what's happening in Bangladesh. Because it's a recurring thing that's happening, people are just ignoring it now.
Don't ignore it. Okay, there's not much you can do on your own. That's true. Join with like-minded people. Join Amnesty International. Join Jubilee Debt Campaign. Join Global Justice Now. Join, if you feel that way, Friends of Palestine, a Shrewsbury group. There are many, many different organisations that are in line with what you want, and you join them. Even if you don't give them any money, you join them. That's nailing your colours to the mast, standing up and being counted. It adds to their statistic, or give them a bit of money, or join them. I mean, there's,
And that's a wonderful note to end on. Thank you, Alison.